Hi, can you hear me? Thank you all for staying on here till the tail end of the tail end. And it's a lovely opportunity. Thank you to the organizers. I was a caregiver, as she has introduced. My mother had dementia, and along the way I met other caregivers. Similar stories, worse stories, and my work of creating online resources was my drop in the ocean, so to say. I focus on home care because that is where most care happens. Even people who finally place their elders with dementia in care facilities, the initial years are always at home. And I'll try to give you some glimpses to understand more about the real life situations and what support and inclusion can mean. I'm not an optimist, so this may not sound very nice. So, okay. See, we don't set out to be home caregivers. I think we all have own careers, you know, there are CAs, consultants, social workers even. And there'll be busy homemakers, there'll be event managers. I myself am an engineer from IIT Delhi and an MBA from IIM Ahmedabad. But then what happens is life makes you a caregiver. And we learn on the situation, crisis by crisis, and not all of us have the personality or inclination to be caregivers, but we become caregivers. Home care is not a 9-to-5 job. It is 24/7. And when it comes on you, you don't get rid of other responsibilities. They still continue. You still have to handle your kids, spouses, career to some extent. You still have to earn money, right? And you still have to handle other elders in the house. You still have to fix repairs, file taxes, get homework done, maybe nag teenagers for competitive exams, whatever. So caregiving requires a major shift in addition to, you know, continuing to handle what is happening. There's a major shift. You have to learn things, you know. They tell you in trainings for dementia that when you're talking to a person with dementia, face the person, be calm, be, you know, all, don't get agitated and all that. They tell you things like that. They tell you don't take the disease personally. If the person says something, don't mind it. Then you come home and, you know, there's this person you've interacted with all your life and you're supposed to change how you talk to them. It's not easy. I mean, we forget half these tips. And then suppose someone is about to touch boiling water. How do you calmly tell them, oh, don't, you know? How do you go in front of them, make eye contact? Or suppose the elder goes and complains wrongly, I'm not talking of abuse, to someone that, you know, she's starving me. Or tells you, you're starving me. How easy would it be, or how difficult would it be, to keep the irritation, hurt, despair out of your voice while talking to them? Neighbors are glaring at you when you cross them in the corridor, you know, abuser, not starving her mother. What do you do? So these sort of adjustments are not easy. And the so-called help and empathy is often totally missing. It lacks understanding, let's say. So I had this caregiver friend. She was looking after her father alone. He was hefty, she was living alone, she didn't want a male attendant. So she was totally ragged out it. And then when she talked in a support group, people would tell her, you know, care for the caregiver, take care of yourself, let go, accept help. And she had no help to accept, you know, it was rubbing salt in her wounds. And she's explaining to them, look, I can't do it. And they're saying, you know, you should take care of yourself. I mean, how? So she actually left the group. And counseling also, I mean, I know there are people here who head counseling and all, but on the ground, there's a lot that still needs to be done because counseling itself has a learning curve at the cost of persons who are counseled early in the journey. So one caregiver, one counselor I knew, she told me once, and she was like very upset about it because she told me she was once counseling this guy about all the things he should do to keep his mother's life happy and active and all that. And he listened to her, you know, she gave this huge list and finally he says, I've got this job and how do I still need to earn money? How do I fit in all this in my day? And then, you know, she realizes that she was mortified. She realizes that she should have listened, she should understand the complexities of home care before spouting off standard stuff. Because a lot of this is just spouting of standard stuff. Fortunately, some things are improving. For example, take wandering. People do know that wandering is a serious problem. That was not the case, you know, like 15, 20 years back. People wouldn't believe. So now when families do take steps to prevent wandering problems, people around are either neutral or supportive. They're not critical. They don't use words like cruel, confining, which they used to use some 15 years back. So maybe Godhi Banna has helped. Maybe, you know, some of the newspaper stories have helped. But things are improving somewhat. But again, even that is not enough. Because even if you take wandering, suppose someone wanders, what happens? You have to immediately kick off a frantic search, because every passing minute, the person may be wandering off. The person may have got into a bus and moved away, got into a train. Person may have fallen off the road. They're getting hungry, they're getting thirsty, there's sun, there's wind, there's rain, there are no toilets. Every minute, this concept of a golden hour, you know, about getting started. Now suppose there's a frail elderly husband who's doing the care. Now he's isolated. How does he kick off this thing on this urgent basis when he's himself, you know, overwhelmed, oh, she's gone off, where has she gone? So suppose someone knows these sort of problems happen. That's when, you know, you can get ideas that, okay, maybe we need services that can do this sort of thing in a hurry. Now, I guess a number of you may be looking for opportunities. So if you know the real life problems, that is, if you listen and know the problems rather than just spout advice, there are plenty of things to do. I'll take the case of homebound caregivers, because as dementia gets worse, the caregivers become more homebound. And so they need home services, which I guess are far better today than they were earlier. But let's just take the case of trained attendants. And a lot of people, they're providing this service, but the actual quality on ground is not very good. I would liken getting a good attendant to a pot of gold. So they lack the skills. Like, I have known caregivers, attendants, who don't know how to give an enema. They lack the attitude. I mean, they'll pretend that the diaper doesn't need change because the shift is getting over. And then they are totally clueless about dementia, most of them. You know, they'll yell at that person. Now, it's bad enough yelling at a person you're caring for. In the case of dementia, it's like terrible. So I'll take one more case of... So then when you're looking at services like home attendance and all that, you need to improve the quality uniformly. It's not enough to have a service. I'll talk of one more area of insensitivity, which is pretty difficult and not talked about normally. It's that in advanced dementia, people get more bedridden and more dependent. Of course, you need home nursing, you need medical care, and all those sort of things. You need support for palliative care. I believe there was a session earlier on palliative care. So you need information, support, hand-holding, all that. But let's talk of the situation, you know, when someone asks you, is your mother bedridden, and you say yes. And they say, does she do everything in bed? And you say yes. Wouldn't she be better off dead? And I don't know what they expect you to do. As a caregiver, what do I do? Should I be continuing to look after my mother, and every time I'm changing her diaper or feeding her, I'm saying, she'd be better off dead? I mean, how inhuman is it? Our inability to understand that people may be different and that dependence is not the same as loss of dignity or worth. We just don't have enough discussions on this. So let's talk about inclusiveness and dementia-friendliness. And I'm not talking of, you know, outings like, you know, go to a shop, go to a restaurant. That's very nice, of course. Or go to a shopping mall. I'm talking about public places, buses, trains, banks. How inclusive are they? I mean, those are not optional, right? But let's talk of something even less optional: hospitals, clinics, private nursing homes. Look at the eye test, dentists. I mean, they just can't handle the attendants are not, the technicians are not trained to do tests. The staff is not trained in general. The layouts are unfriendly. The signage is unfriendly. I mean, these are not optional places, right? So when we look at these things of inclusiveness and support, I mean, there's so many things. The infrastructural changes to be made. There are things like, you know, architectures to be changed, ramps or whatever, whether ramps or whatever else. Then there are things like trained staff. Then there's also a concept of dementia friends. You know, you have some people who have been, who understand dementia somewhat better so they can help the family around. So all these things are possible. All these things need to be done. And in a place like this, I should probably point out that when you have senior-friendly places, you must remember that dementia probability grows up with age. So anything that is senior-friendly will need to be dementia-friendly for your existing users also, because some of them will go on to develop dementia. So I'd like to sort of point out, and I think Dr. Khwaja has done quite a bit of that, but you know, we normally talk of support in terms of products, services, facilities, trained staff and all those sort of nice things you set up. But support and inclusion are not just about that. We have to be able to shift the discomfort we have with diverse human conditions. We have to remove the othering of these people. When we talk about inclusion, you know, we talk like there's a we who's going to include them, or there's a we who has to be included by them. That's not the way it is. If we just give it a thought, that's not the way it is. Rosalind Carter, the wife of President Jimmy Carter, very famously once said, there are only four kinds of people in the world. Those who have been caregivers, those who are caregivers, those who will be caregivers, and those who will need caregivers. I'd like to leave that as a thought with you. Thank you.